Princeton University Press Audio presents Brooklyn, the Once and Future City by Thomas J. Campanella, read by William Hope. In memory of my parents, Mario and Rose Campanella. And joy suddenly stirred in his soul, and he even stopped for a minute to take breath. The past, he thought, is linked with the present by an unbroken chain of events flowing one out of another. And it seemed to him that he had just seen both ends of that chain, that when he touched one end, the other quivered. Chekhov, the student. Introduction. What is Brooklyn that thou art mindful of her? Psalm 8, verse 4, modified. This book is about the shaping of Brooklyn's extraordinary urban landscape. Its focus is not the celebrated sites and landmarks of the tourist map, though many of those appear, but rather the Brooklyn unknown, overlooked, and unheralded. The quotidian city taken for granted or long ago blotted out by time and tide. In the pages that follow, I hope to breathe fresh life into lost and forgotten chapters of Brooklyn's urban past, to shed light on the visions, ideals, and forces of creative destruction that have forged the city we know today. Spanning 500 years of history, the book's scope encompasses the built as well as unbuilt, the noble and the sham, triumphs as well as failures, dashed dreams and stillborn schemes and plans that never had a chance. The book casts new light on a place as overexposed as it is understudied. It is not a comprehensive history, nor one driven by a grand thesis, but rather a telling that plates key strands of Brooklyn's past into a narrative about the once and future city. It is a recovery operation of sorts, the Cabinet of Curiosities tour of the Brooklyn obscure, of the city before gentrification and global fame, that mythical dominion, as Truman Capote put it, against whose shore the Coney Island Sea laps a wintry lament. The Quivering Chain. Brooklyn may be a brand known around the world, but it is also terra incognita, a terrain long lost in the thermonuclear glow of Manhattan, possibly the most navel-gazed city in the world outside of Rome, and the subject of dozens of good books. With some exceptions, the Brooklyn Bridge, Coney Island, the gentrification of brownstone Brooklyn, and the grassroots struggles to fight poverty and discrimination in Bedford-Stuyvesant and East New York, the story of Brooklyn's urban landscape remains largely untold, the subject of only a handful of texts beyond the usual guidebooks and nostalgia-laden compendia of old photographs. Little or nothing has been written about how Gravesend was the first town planned by a woman in America, how Greenwood Cemetery was not only a place of burial but effectively New York's first great public park, how Ocean Parkway fused a Yankee pastoral idea to boulevard design lifted from Second Empire Paris to create America's greatest Elm Street, about how the long-vanished Sheepshead Bay racetrack became the toast of the thoroughbred world, birthplace of the Big Apple, and later the launching point of the first airplane flight across the United States, or about how Marine Park was nearly chosen as the site for what ultimately became the 1939 New York World's Fair. We know equally little about the rise and fall of Floyd Bennett Field, New York's first municipal airport and the most technically advanced airfield in the world when it opened, or about the 30-year political tug-of-war that nearly made Jamaica Bay the world's largest deep-water seaport, complete with the earliest known proposal for containerized shipping, or how a long-forgotten piece of 1920s tax legislation unleashed the greatest residential building boom in American history, one that churned Brooklyn's vast southern hemisphere, much of it farmed since the 1630s, into a dominion of mock Tudor and Dutch colonial homes, or the vast urban renewal and expressway projects that Robert Moses unleashed on Brooklyn after World War II, the largest, most ambitious, and most devastating in the United States. All of these are among the subjects of this book. If this work is about the one-time futures of past generations, to quote Reinhard Koselleck, it is also about the city today. For the past is a dark moon that tugs at our orbital plane, moving it in barely perceptible ways, exerting, as Pete Hamill has put it, an almost tidal pull upon the present and on our lives. The urban landscape has a long memory, an LP record with brick and mortar grooves. That which seems long gone is often still about our feet, hidden in plain sight. The urban past is all around us, and it conditions and qualifies the present. The modern city is replete with palimpsests and pentimenti, stubborn stains and traces of what went before, keepsakes that beckon us to unpack and explore and to understand. This book is an excavation, then, and an invitation to see Brooklyn afresh, to discover that its remotest corners and most familiar places are all layered with memory, alive with meaning and significance. Put another way, it aims to uncover that great cable that links us to the past, what Anton Chekhov described in one of his favorite works, The Student, 1894, as the unbroken chain of events flowing one out of another that leads back from the present. Chekhov's protagonist is a clerical student named Ivan Velikopolsky, who relates the story of St. Peter's denial to a pair of elderly widows on a cold winter's night. Seeing them deeply moved by his telling, Velikopolsky suddenly understands the enduring power of narrative to convey passion and breathe life into the past. And it seemed to him that he had just seen both ends of that chain, that when he touched one end, the other quivered. Brooklyn, long-settled western rump of that glacial pile known as Long Island, has been many things to many peoples over the last 500 years. It was home to the Lenni Lenape Nation of Algonquian peoples for at least a millennium by the time Giovanni de Verrazzano cruised its shores in 1524. To European eyes, it was virgin terrain, a fresh green breast of the New World, as Nick Carraway marveled in The Great Gatsby, a tabula rasa upon which a whole new script for civilization could be written. It became a rural province of New Netherland until the English named it the West Riding of Yorkshire and, in 1683, King's County. For the next 150 years, this plantation realm fed the rising city across the river, engaging in cultural practices, including chattel slavery, that rendered it closer in spirit to the American South than to New England or the rest of New York. Its quarter closest to Manhattan, the town of Brooklyn proper, became America's first commuter suburb, a ferry ride and a world away from the rush and bustle of the city. Brooklyn evolved into a tranquil realm of churches and homes where affluent New Yorkers, gentlemen of taste and fortune, could raise their families safely away from the chaos of urban life. Others came for eternity, tucked beneath the trees and turf in Greenwood Cemetery, premier resting place for the silk stocking set from Brooklyn and New York alike. The teeming masses also came, decanted from the rookeries of the Lower East Side and Harlem, to make Brooklyn home and to labor in the factories of Williamsburg and the Fifth Ward, the busiest industrial quarter in North America for nearly a century. Among them were my own immigrant forebears, who left Little Italy for the relative spaciousness and opportunity across the East River. By the 1880s, the city of Brooklyn was a strapping, self-assured junior rival of New York, with dreams, schemes, and ambitions all its own. This was the Brooklyn that created America's greatest rural cemetery, whose shipyards and factories armed the Union during the Civil War, that commissioned Olmsted and Vaux to create their career masterpiece at Prospect Park, that spanned the East River with the longest suspension bridge in the world, that was Gotham's playground for a generation where rich and poor alike gathered at racetracks and turreted seaside hotels and on the beaches of Coney Island. By the time Roebling's Great Bridge opened in May 1883, Brooklyn was all of 50 years old. Founded in 1834, it grew like a weed in manure over the next half century, zipping past Baltimore, Boston, New Orleans, and Cincinnati to become the third largest city in America by the Civil War. It swelled from annexation as well as immigration, absorbing Bushwick and the upstart city of Williamsburg in 1855, new lots in 1886, and the far-flung country towns of Flatbush, Flatlands, Gravesend, and New Utrecht by 1896. Brooklyn thus reached the apogee of its arc, its moment of maximum power and influence. And then, as we will see, everything changed. The alchemy of identity. How did Brooklyn become itself? What forces have shaped its singular character and identity? Limning the soul of any city, its genius loci, to quote Christian Norberg Schultz, the slippery stuff that gives a place timbre, pitch, and intensity is no easy feat. It is multivalent, runs deep, and is in a constant state of flux. Brooklyn's place spirit formed over several centuries and around two principal fulcrums. The first was the land itself. Brooklyn's distinctive topography of terminal moraine and outwash plain is a legacy of the last ice age, an era that ended some 10,000 years ago. The miles-deep Laurentide ice sheet was a bulldozer of the gods, gouging out the Finger Lakes, grinding down the Adirondacks, and carving the Hudson Valley, only to lose its mojo in the vicinity of present-day Gotham. Here, it advanced and retreated twice, as if suddenly unsure of its mission, and left in its wake a great pile of scree known today as Long Island. The backbone of this heap, the conjoined Harbor Hill and Ronkonkoma moraines, is Whitman's Brooklyn of Ample Hills, a line of elevated ground well charted by place names: Bay Ridge, Brooklyn Heights, Park Slope, Prospect Park, Crown Heights, Ocean Hill. Below and south of this is the Outwash Plain, a vast, low-slung territory that formed as a glacial meltwater, and thousands of years of rain flushed much of the high ground toward the sea. The terminal moraine is thus Brooklyn's continental divide, cleaving the borough into two distinct halves: a hilly, Manhattan-oriented northern hemisphere, and a broad, low-slung southern hemisphere closer in spirit to Long Island's South Shore, a landscape as flat and huge as Kansas, wrote James Agee, horizon beyond horizon forever unfolded. As we will see throughout the book, this ancient glacial binary, terminal moraine and outwash plain, has played a vital role in Brooklyn's growth and development, and remains a key to understanding the borough today. Map the creative class in Brooklyn, and you'll see a ghost of glacial history appear before your eyes. North of the moraine, a stone's throw from Manhattan, is the city of rapid gentrification, where elders and the poor are dislodged by implacable market forces, where even a tiny apartment now costs a king's ransom, and nothing, it seems, is not artisanal, batch-made, or cruelty-free. Outwash Brooklyn, basically everything south of a line from Owl's Head Park in Bay Ridge to Broadway Junction at the Queens border, remains a dominion of immigrant strivers and working-class stiffs, of quiet middle-class bedroom communities, and the occasional pocket of both wealth, Midwood and Manhattan Beach, and deep poverty, Brownsville and East New York. It is a world scored still by old lines of race, class, and religion, where you can walk for hours without passing a hipster, a Starbucks, or a bar with retro Edison light bulbs, where there are entire communities with ties closer to Tel Aviv, Fuzhou, Kingston, or Kiev than to the rest of the United States. The second fulcrum vital to Brooklyn's singularity among cities is its fatal adjacency to Manhattan Island. The relationship between Brooklyn and New York, composed of Manhattan alone until 1874 when it annexed part of the Bronx, has long been a dynamic and complicated one. To the colonial rulers of New Amsterdam and New York, and to the subsequent American city, Brooklyn was the ideal hinterland. Close at hand, and yet literally and symbolically a separate place, insulated from the center by a natural moat, the treacherous, fast-moving East River. Conditional proximity, for lack of a better term, made Brooklyn a displacement zone of sorts, a site for peoples and practices untenable in the heart of town. Suspect religions, racial outcasts, citizen nonconformists, and later, dirty industrial operations and morally polluting amusements. In this borderland beyond the gates, new freedoms and liberties were abided because they posed little threat to the sanctum sanctorum. And so it was across the East River, away from New Amsterdam, that an unorthodox religious group, Deborah Moody's Anabaptists and the Quakers, who later joined them, was permitted to establish a settlement in which religious freedom was guaranteed by law. It was across the river, too, that corrupt Dutch West India Company officials were able to make huge illegal land grabs, and that slavery was far more deeply embedded than in the progressive core. And yet it was also there that freedmen and slaves escaping north on the Underground Railroad and blacks fleeing the terror of the draft riots found sanctuary in the African-American settlement of Weeksville and among sympathizers on the very farms in flatlands that once held men in bondage. As New York grew, so did Brooklyn. It hatched at the river's edge, eyes fixed on the lodestar city across the way. And just as Manhattan grew north from the Battery, giving the world that enduring binary of uptown and downtown, Brooklyn began in the north and spread south. Put another way, Brooklyn reversed Manhattan's polarity. Brooklyn, north of the terminal moraine, hardened into cityscape by about 1915. Nearly everything to its south, with the exception of the old rural towns, the amusement district in Coney Island, and a handful of early subdivisions along major axes like Ocean and Fort Hamilton Parkways and Flatbush Avenue, Kensington, Ditmas Park, Blythborn and New Utrecht, Bensonhurst by the Sea, Dean Alvord's Prospect Park South subdivision in Flatbush, with Albemarle Road modeled on Boston's Commonwealth Avenue, remained in rural slumber for another generation. Not until the great building boom of the 1920s did the metropolitan tide wash across the broad and beautiful plain, as Henry Stiles called it, of Brooklyn's southern hemisphere. Incredibly, not until the mid-2000s were the last vacant blocks in Brooklyn's deepest south, along Avenue N in Georgetown, finally built up. From the start, the relationship between Brooklyn and New York was one of reluctant symbiosis. Brooklyn suckled at Gotham's teat, gaining in size and strength by tapping the great city's flows of people, goods, and capital. The radiant glow of New York, flagship American metropolis, fueled Brooklyn's fierce drive and ambition. Like a self-possessed kid who refuses to be bullied by a star older sibling, Brooklyn's civic leaders were driven to match New York drink for drink. It was a competitive relationship of the best sort, with Brooklyn punching above its weight in round after round for most of the 19th century. After New York built Central Park, Brooklyn hired the same designers to create an even finer work of landscape art across the river. Land-starved Manhattan could never have a rural cemetery like Brooklyn's Greenwood, de rigueur for any city worth its salt in the middle years of the 19th century. So self-confident was this rising city, so suffused with youthful energy, that it had the moxie to cast a steel cable net across the East River to catch hold of mighty Manhattan itself. For Brooklyn understood that if it owed its existence to the great city across the way, the reverse was also true. Without Brooklyn, New York would never have become a great metropolis. Land poor and girdled by water, the island city was in the condition of a walled town, wrote Frederick Law Olmsted, and would have choked on itself without a vast hinterland across the river. And as Gotham grew, Brooklyn became ever more vital to its existence. Brooklyn fed New York, took its trash, decanted its masses, housed its workforce, manufactured its goods, and buried its dead. At Brighton Beach and Coney Island, that clitoral appendage at the entrance to New York Harbor, as Rem Koolhaas memorably put it, the moral corsets of New York society were loosened. There, all manner of conduct unbecoming, drinking, gambling, whoring, was not only tolerated, but well served. Coney Island enabled and sustained Manhattan's hyperdensity by bleeding off the pressures and energy of the metropolitan core, playing id to its massive ego. Watershed, 1898. Of course, proximity to Manhattan had its risks. Like an acorn that sprouts too near the great oak from which it fell, it was inevitable that Brooklyn would eventually be eclipsed by the Goliath next door. That moment came on the cold and rainy night of December 31, 1897. As the clock struck 12, the city of Brooklyn passed into history, extinguished for the greater glory of greater New York City, what the New York Tribune called the greatest experiment in municipal government that the world has ever known. While rockets burst over jubilant revelers in Manhattan, Brooklyn's social and cultural elite mourned the demise of their proud, independent city. The moral center of New York, as the Daily Eagle ruefully put it. Never had so large and influential a metropolis been so subsumed by a neighboring rival. Consolidation, overnight, made New York the largest city on earth after London, fulfilling Gotham's imperial destiny, as Abraham S. Hewitt put it in 1887, as the greatest city in the world. The mastermind of this forced marriage was Andrew Haswell Green, an extraordinary administrative polymath and political reformer who built many public works, broke the Tweed Ring, helped create Central Park, and founded a succession of major institutions, among them the New York Public Library, American Museum of Natural History, and New York Zoological Park, Bronx Zoo. It was in an 1868 memo to the Central Park Commission that Green first sketched out his vision of a future city under one common municipal government. Consolidation was never a popular movement in Brooklyn, but it had the backing of merchants, bankers, and the powerful real estate industry. It was also supported by that dean of Brooklyn's civic life, James S. T. Stranahan, a Green-like spirit who, as we will see, played a formative role in creating Prospect Park and the Brooklyn Bridge. Consolidation was Stranahan's last great campaign. He died just months after its consummation. As the issue came to a head, the Brooklyn Consolidation League and other groups canvassed the city to convince voters that being part of Greater New York would halve Brooklyn taxes, clear its mounting debt, raise property values, and bring about a profusion of public works, including access to Croton Water and a much-needed second bridge across the East River. The Consolidation League was checked by the fiercely anti-consolidationist editorial board of the Eagle and by a well-funded group known as the League of Loyal Citizens. Though it included some of Brooklyn's most respected church and civic leaders, the League used scare tactics that alienated many potential supporters. Much of this fear-mongering involved race, ethnicity, and religion. The League depicted Manhattan as a whoring mammon that would contaminate the pure and pious city of churches. Its vision of Brooklyn was a city of native-born citizens trained from childhood in American traditions, a white Protestant motherland with deep Yankee roots that risked being overrun by the swarthy immigrant hordes of the Lower East Side, the political sewage of Europe, as the Reverend Richard S. Storrs of Brooklyn Heights put it. The consolidation referendum was approved by nearly 37,000 votes in New York. In Brooklyn, it passed by a mere 277. Field of Dreams. Consolidation profoundly altered the genetic code of Brooklyn, as if its DNA had been exposed to a potent source of radiation. But the effects were delayed, like an illness that lay dormant for years before showing signs or symptoms. For most of a generation, Brooklyn's old guard Protestant elite stayed put and continued to campaign for the improvement of their beloved city, even if it was now a mere borough of Greater New York. To Manhattanite expansionists like Andrew Green, meanwhile, Brooklyn was a vast field of dreams, a tabula rasa onto which all sorts of metropolitan fantasies could be projected. The colonizing gaze hardly troubled Brooklyn's elite, for Greater New York's expansionist plans, its embrace of Brooklyn as a kind of testbed and laboratory for urban experimentation, elided seamlessly with Brooklyn's own ambitions for growth, development, and greatness. This created, from about 1900 to the mid-1930s, a synergy that fueled an extraordinary range of projects and proposals promoted by Brooklyn boosters and metropolitan expansionists alike. Two more bridges across the East River, subway lines, a great waterfront park that included the world's biggest sports stadium, a deepwater port larger than anything in Europe, the best airport in North America. It was also to Brooklyn in this period that, much as its Protestant old guard feared, countless immigrants from across the East River came to find their American dream. The Manhattan and Williamsburg bridges decanted the overcrowded tenements of the Lower East Side, channeling tens of thousands of working-class Germans, Scandinavians, Jews, Italians, Poles, and Irish into Williamsburg, Bushwick, Greenpoint, Red Hook, Sunset Park, and the industrial district west of the Navy Yard. By the mid-1920s, a residential building boom unprecedented in U.S. history had created a vast tapestry of middle-class streetcar suburbs across Brooklyn's outwash plain, where young families could find room to swing a cat, as P.G. Wodehouse and Jerome Kern versed it in Nesting Time in Flatbush. The coming of so many Catholic and Jewish Southern and Eastern Europeans in this era was a last straw of sorts for Brooklyn's Anglo-Dutch elite. By the late 1920s, they were fleeing in droves for the upscale suburbs of Westchester, Long Island, and New Jersey. My mother used to recall how on walks with her father in the 1930s, she would marvel at the aged Anglo-Dutch widows sweeping the stoops of their glorious brownstones on South Oxford Street. Last of their breed, they were relics of a lost world whose families had long ago fled to Scarsdale, Bronxville, or the North Shore. In a vassal state, the Great Depression brought about another inflection point in Brooklyn's evolution. By the mid-1930s, the old order of Anglo-Dutch Brooklyn had largely been supplanted by the borough's surging white ethnic population. The newcomers were fiercely ambitious in their own right, but also keenly aware of their provisional status in a society still dominated by its white Anglo-Saxon charter culture. One did not have to travel far to find evidence of just how hated one was as a Jew or Catholic in America. When Al Smith campaigned for the presidency in 1928, There were Klan rallies and cross burnings all over Long Island. Internalizing outsider status can fuel deep anxiety about one's place in the world and breed a sense of self-loathing. In Brooklyn, these immigrant insecurities were validated and confirmed by the borough's own subaltern outer rank vis-a-vis mighty Manhattan. By now, the keen competitive stance Brooklyn once had with its East River rival, its eagerness to beat Manhattan at its own game, had greatly diminished. Consolidation robbed Brooklyn of not only its independence, but much of its moxie and optimism. After World War II, the once proud city had developed a gnawing inferiority complex. Brooklyn began to see itself as colonized terrain, a vassal state forever in Manhattan's shadow. It was the eternal underdog, feisty and bombastic, and yet consumed by a chronic sense of inadequacy, of Fredo Corleone of cities. The enduring symbol of this subaltern realm was, of course, the Brooklyn Dodgers, a club defeated in 6 out of 7 World Series matchups with the New York Yankees, and that finally triumphed in 1955, only to double-cross their fans by departing for sunny California 2 years later. The Dodger betrayal became a bitter trope for all the crushed hopes and failures of post-war Brooklyn and its white ethnic social order. Of course, self-loathing is generally returned with gleeful interest by the world. Brooklyn became the punching bag of cities, the butt of jokes, an object of ridicule that the rest of America could look down its long wasp nose at. Brooklyn's husky patois, dog for dog, pitcher for picture, and of course coffee, was mocked from stage and screen. Rapidly vanishing now, it was something to wrap one's ears about. I remember an aunt telling a story at my grandmother's Borough Park dinner table when I was a child, something involving an earl. Confused, I thought she was referring to English royalty. I tugged my father's sleeve and whispered, "Dad, who is this earl?" Rarely heard today, earl was how working-class Brooklynites of a certain age pronounced oil. Conversely, the word earl itself would have been pronounced oil, which recalls the great Rodgers and Hart song, Manhattan, made famous by Ella Fitzgerald, in which a love-struck boy and Goyle marvel at the city's romantic allure. But the ridicule could be brutal, and always the most withering came from the high cultural elite, the same class that now stumbles over itself for a Park Slope brownstone, whose trust-funded children have colonized the industrial wastes of Red Hook and Bushwick. Exeter and Harvard-educated James Agee, on a failed 1939 assignment for Fortune magazine, ventured bravely across the East River to discover in Brooklyn a curious quality in the eyes and at the corners of the mouths relative to what is seen on Manhattan Island, a kind of drugged softness or narcotic relaxation, much the same look seen in monasteries and in the lawns of sanitariums. And though possessing something of a center, and hands, and eyes, and feet, Brooklyn was, in A.G.'s view, mostly an exorbitant, pulsing mass of scarcely discriminable cellular jellies and tissues, a place where people merely live. To Truman Capote, Brooklyn was a benighted realm filled with sad, sweet, violent children, homeland of the Philistine mediocrity, the man who guards averageness with morbid intensity. He called Brooklyn a veritable veldt of tawdriness, where even the nom de quartier aggravate. Flatbush and Flushing Avenue, Bushwick, Brownsville, Red Hook. Any mention of it brought forth compulsory guffaws, he mused, for Brooklyn was the nation's laughingstock. As a group, Brooklynites form a persecuted minority, he wrote in 1946. Their dialect, appearance, and manners have become synonymous with the crudest, most vulgar aspects of contemporary life. Capote heaped plenty of highbrow scorn on Brooklyn, but even he recoiled at just how cruel all this mirth-making at the borough's expense could be. The teasing, which perhaps began good-naturedly enough, has turned the razory road toward malice, he observed. An address in Brooklyn is now not altogether respectable. He also understood the borough's vast complexity better than most. To Capote, Brooklyn was terribly funny, but also sad, brutal, provincial, lonesome, human, silent, sprawling, raucous, lost, passionate, subtle, bitter, immature, perverse, tender, mysterious. Capote moved to Brooklyn not long after penning those lines, renting an apartment in the Willow Street home of his friend, set designer and former February house denizen Oliver Smith. I live in Brooklyn, Capote wrote in perhaps the greatest backhanded compliment ever paid a city, by choice. Often the most bitter vitriol came from the borough's own, to whom success was a measure of distance gained from their native place. My mother could be scornful of family and friends who stayed put in her old neighborhood by the Brooklyn Navy Yard. Indeed, the mark of arrival was to leave. The idea, wrote Pete Hamill, was to get out. Henry Miller reviled the Bushwick and Williamsburg of his youth, describing Myrtle Avenue as a street not of sorrow, for sorrow would be human and recognizable, but of sheer emptiness. It is emptier than the most extinct volcano, than the word God in the mouth of an unbeliever. Down this grim way, no miracle ever passed, nor any poet, nor any species of human genius, nor did any flower ever grow there, nor did the sun strike it squarely, nor did the rain ever wash it. See Myrtle Avenue before you die, he implored, if only to realize how far into the future Dante saw. Age did nothing to diminish Miller's odium. In a 1975 documentary, the octogenarian author recalled his birthplace as a shithole, a place where I knew nothing but starvation, humiliation, despair, frustration, every goddamn thing, nothing but misery. Such deep loathing for one's birthplace and cradle created a population that, as we will see, tolerated some of the most egregious acts of urban vandalism in post-war America. Place hatred does not breed a culture of civic activism or preservation, especially when it's fused with poverty. This is one of the reasons why city officials were able to raise unopposed most of the blocks south of the Navy Yard for the largest single housing project in American history. And why Robert Moses was able to bulldoze the Brooklyn Queens Expressway across Red Hook and Williamsburg with nary a whimper from the locals, when a similar project in the Bronx, the Cross Bronx Expressway, raised howls of opposition from the people of East Tremont, who loved their neighborhood and fought bitterly to save it. It may well be that Brooklyn's strange alchemy of ambition and self-loathing is precisely why it has churned out more raw talent than any other city in America. The sons and daughters of Brooklyn were hungry, straining at the harness, eager to prove themselves to a cynical, mocking world, or at least to that exalted realm across the East River, the very incarnation of worldly power, wealth, and splendor. And they did just that. There is no quarter of modern life in America that Brooklyn's gifted offspring have not touched or transformed. And there were plenty of offspring to go around. It is often said that a quarter of all Americans can trace their family ancestry through Brooklyn. Even a partial list of luminaries born or raised in this crossroads of the world is dazzling. Aaliyah, Woody Allen, Darren Aronofsky, Isaac Asimov, zoning pioneer Edward Murray Bassett, Pat Benatar, Mel Brooks, William M. Calder, father of daylight saving time, Al Capone, Shirley Chisholm, Aaron Copland, Milton Friedman, George and Ira Gershwin, Rudy Giuliani, Doris Kearns Goodwin, Arlo Guthrie, Lena Horne, the Horowitz brothers of Three Stooges fame, Jay-Z, Jenny Jerome, Winston Churchill's mother, Michael Jordan, Alfred Kazin, Harvey Keitel, Carole King, C. Everett Koop, Spike Lee, Jonathan Lethem, housing pioneer William Levitt, Vince Lombardi, Norman Mailer, Arthur Miller, and Henry Miller, Zero Mostel, Eddie Murphy, The Notorious B.I.G., Rosie Perez, Norman Pod Horitz, Nobel physicist Isadore I. Robbie, Lou Reed, Buddy Rich, Joan Rivers, Chris Rock, Carl Sagan, U.S. Senators Bernie Sanders and Chuck Schumer, Jerry Seinfeld, Beverly Sills, Nobel economist Robert Solow, Barbara Stanwyck and Barbara Streisand, George C. Tillieu, John Turturro, Mike Tyson, Wendy Wasserstein, Walt Whitman, the Beastie Boys, Adam Yauch. Brooklyn reached its peak of population in the immediate wake of World War II, a conflict it played no small part in winning. 70,000 workers at the Navy Yard churned out 17 warships between 1940 and 1945, including some of the most powerful ever built. But the winds of fortune changed fast. As we will see, a confluence of internal and external forces, the collapse of industry and loss of factory jobs, the lure of the suburbs, surging street crime, a breakdown of social order, began pulling Brooklyn apart. By the mid-1970s, when I was a child growing up in Marine Park, Brooklyn had been brought to its knees. Racked by a cacophony of social ills, Brooklyn, indeed, most of New York, was a city under siege. More than 500,000 residents had fled the borough by then, panicked by its changing demographics, spooked by the boogeyman of race, paralyzed by legitimate fears of violent crime. The serial loss of anchor institutions, the Brooklyn Eagle, 1955, the Dodgers, 1957, Ebbets Field, 1960, Steeplechase Park, 1964, the Navy Yard, 1966, convinced them that the borough's best years were behind it. And so they left, abandoning some of the most glorious residential urbanism in North America for car-dependent suburbs, trading townhouses and Tudor Castle apartments for stick-built ranch homes in subdivisions shorn of street life and far from the centers of culture, pawning, in effect, the family jewels for a car and a cardboard box. It would remain for their children and grandchildren to find a path back and rediscover the extraordinary place they had left behind. Chapter 1. The Natal Shore. There is toward the sea a large piece of low flat land, overflowed at every tide. Jasper Dankertz and Peter Sloiter, 1679. Amidst the leafy quietude of East 35th Street in Marine Park, far from the hipsters or the merchants of Twee, there is a spectacle as unique and unlikely as a Hollywood stage set. The Hendrick I. Lott House is one of New York City's most extraordinary survivors, a virtually unaltered keepsake from Gotham's distant past that sits among its upstart neighbors like an old cat sleeping in the sun. The house occupies a spacious lot, but it once commanded an empire of earth that swept south and west from King's Highway to Jamaica Bay. Canted a few degrees off the street grid as if in protest of municipal edict, the Lott House is among the oldest homes in New York and a superlative example of Dutch-American vernacular architecture that, unlike most other colonial holdouts in the city, has sat on the same foundation for over 200 years. Incredibly, the Lott House was occupied by the same family until 1989, the longest tenure of any in New York City history. I remember well its elderly last occupant, Ella Sudam, a librarian at Aramis Hall High School, who would wave to us boys as we gaped wide-eyed at the country house in the middle of town. Sudam, a neighborhood character who swept her porch in a 1930s fur coat, was, incredibly, the great-great-great-great-granddaughter of Johannes Lott, who built the east section of the house in 1719, the year my favorite childhood book was published, Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe. The long rural southern hemisphere of Brooklyn was brought into Gotham's pale in the 1920s, as the city grew south and east in its most exuberant era of expansion. Municipal water and sewer infrastructure had only just been extended to this part of town, service that, combined with a roaring economy and a 10-year tax holiday, stoked an unprecedented frenzy of residential development. Fields first plowed in the 17th century now brought forth a last great crop of mock Tudor homes. This remarkable metamorphosis, from countryside to cityscape almost overnight, is well documented thanks to a 26-year-old aviation entrepreneur named Sherman Fairchild, whose fledgling Fairchild Aerial Survey Company had photographed every inch of Manhattan in 1922 with a fast new camera of his own design. The images were tiled together to produce a map 20 inches wide and more than 8 feet long. The following year, Fairchild was commissioned by city engineer Arthur S. Tuttle to do the same for all of New York. By the summer of 1924, his camera plane had flown nearly 3,000 miles back and forth over the city, snapping some 2,900 images of the five boroughs from an altitude of 10,000 feet. These were assembled into a great mosaic to produce an 8-by-12-foot aerial portrait of the Big Apple, the first comprehensive photographic map of any city in the world. It revealed, among other things, the hungry grid of metropolis about to consume the old lot farm, Brooklyn's last rural landscape. Fairchild's camera planes came not a moment too soon, for the very next year, 1925, was the last that Johannes Lott's rustic spread would be tilled. Sherman Fairchild's photo mosaic thus captured in the wink of a mechanical eye a 200-year-old pastoral realm at the very end of its days. Lott was a pioneer, to be sure, but hardly the first European in this vernal corner of the New World. Flatlands had been colonized for close to a century by now and had been home to Native Americans for untold centuries before that. At the northern boundary of Lott's land was an old Indian crossroads, the present-day junction of Flatbush Avenue and King's Highway. Heavily trafficked thoroughfares today, they still roughly follow ancient alignments, which explains why both roads look like random rips in the urban fabric on a map of the city. At the juncture of these trade routes was once the Canarsie Indian settlement of Keskakeron, or Keskachogue, Keskachok in modern Long Island nomenclature, a principal council site of the tribes of western Long Island and possibly the seat of Pennewitz, a powerful, peaceable sachem and friend of the Dutch. One of several chieftaincies scattered across Long Island at the time of European contact, the Canarsie lived in semi-permanent settlements made up of small matrilineal family groups. They drew sustenance from land and water, gathering chestnuts, fishing, hunting, and harvesting shellfish, cultivating maize, beans, pumpkins, and squash. They were part of the Lenni Lenape nation of Algonquian peoples that once occupied much of the northeast coast, and whose place names, Gowanus, Hackensack, Manhattan, Passaic, Rockaway, Weehawken, are the toponymy of daily life in metropolitan New York. Keskachogue was on the edge of a broad expanse known as the Plains, or the Great Flats, which extended north to about where Brooklyn College is today. It was the largest of three such plains in the area that were among the few natural prairies east of the Allegheny Mountains. These long-vanished grasslands were surrounded by woods, but treeless except for an occasional ancient oak or pine tree. In places, they were planted to maize by the Canarsie. They were formed in part by the centuries of periodic burning by Native Americans to facilitate travel, clear underbrush for camps and cultivation, kill off ticks and fleas, and increase the forest edge habitat favored by game animals, turkey, grouse, quail, deer, rabbits. We recall these miniature prairies today in the name given this part of Long Island by the English, Flatlands. Something of their character may be gleaned from a description by Timothy Dwight of the larger Hempstead Plain, farther east on Long Island, a tiny fragment of which may still be seen between Nassau Coliseum and the Meadowbrook Parkway. Then, serving a grueling term as president of Yale College, Dwight took a series of extended autumn journeys through New York and New England in the 1790s, one of which covered the length of Long Island. Dwight found the Hempstead Plain to be absolutely barren in some places, but elsewhere covered by a long, coarse wild grass, or thinly forested with pine or shrubby oaks, the most shriveled and puny that I ever met with. Except for peninsular intrusions of forest into the plain, the terrain was relieved only by occasional clusters of trees such as the Isle of Pines, which, at a distance, he noted, resembles not a little a real island. Keskachogue appears on the earliest surviving map of New Netherland, the remarkable Manitus map of 1639. The document, produced by either the Dutch cartographer Johannes Vingboons or colonial surveyor Andreas Hude, was found hanging on a wall at the Villa Castello near Florence and later moved to Michelangelo's Biblioteca Medicea Lorenziana. The nearly identical Harissa copy, a detail of which is reproduced here, is held by the Library of Congress. On the map, Keskachaug is shown just east of Kanye Island, marked by a longhouse noted as the habitation typical of De Wilden Keskachau, the savages of Keskachoga. We don't know what this structure looked like, but it was likely similar to an Indian longhouse several miles to the west at New Utrecht, described in a remarkable document discovered in an Amsterdam bookshop in 1864. A travel journal by two visiting missionaries from Friesland, Jasper Dankerts and Peter Sloiter. While riding along the marshy shore near today's Fort Hamilton, the pair heard the sound of pounding and discovered nearby an elderly Indian woman beating Turkish beans, maize, out of the pods by means of a stick. We went from thence to her habitation, where we found the whole troop together consisting of 7 or 8 families. Their house low and long, about 60 feet long and 14 or 15 feet wide. The bottom was earth, the sides and roof were made of reed and the bark of chestnut trees. The posts, or columns, were limbs of trees stuck in the ground and all fastened together. The roof ridge of the longhouse was left open a half a foot the entire length of the structure, allowing smoke to escape from cooking fires below. These were built in the middle of the floor, noted the men, according to the number of families which live in it, so that from one end to the other each of them boils its own pot and eats when it likes. The Keskachaug longhouse was probably located at the headwaters of a certain kill or creek coming out of the sea, a tidal estuary of Jamaica Bay known as Waywitspritner to the Indians, the Stroomkill to the Dutch, and Gerritsen Creek today. The Stroomkill is Brooklyn's natal stream. Once extending as far north as King's Highway, it was the longest of the many tidal inlets that scoured the outwash plain above Jamaica Bay, so cleaving the landscape that the Dutch called it Broekelen, the fractured lands. As Daniel Denton observed in 1670, such crystal streams on Long Island's south shore not only teemed with fish, sheep's head, plaice, perch, trouts, eels, turtles, but ran so swift that they purged themselves of such stinking mud and filth, and were thus unlikely to harbor fevers and other distempers. The cultural history of the Stromkill may date back some 1,500 years, when post-Ice Age sea levels stabilized and the modern coastline of Long Island began to take form. As Frederick Van Wyck speculated in 1924, the tidal estuary probably contains more undisturbed traces of the Indians than are to be found in any other part of Brooklyn, possibly in any other part of the city of New York. It was on the western shore of the Stromkill that a Canarsie Indian village and wampum works known as Shanscomacoke once stood. Evidence of long occupation of this place by Native Americans came to light slowly in the 19th century. Farmers found arrowheads on the beach. Vast shell banks, or middens, were revealed by tides and erosion. When Avenue U was constructed at the turn of the 19th century, human skeletons were unearthed in graves filled with still-sealed oyster shells, meant, perhaps, as sustenance in the afterlife. It was around this time that an amateur archaeologist named Daniel Barry Austin began digging at Garretson Creek. Austin was an accomplished photographer with a day job at Standard Oil, but his real passion was the indigenous history of Long Island. Equal parts hoarder and scientist, Austin amassed a breathtaking collection of artifacts over his lifetime. He crammed more than 10,000 items into his modest home on East 14th Street in Midwood, some 1,500 of which were from sites in Brooklyn alone. This included several skeletons stored, quite literally, in his closet. One of these probably came from the vicinity of Avenue U and Burnett Street, where Austin discovered a dozen graves, each spaced 35 feet apart from one another. Sometime later, just to the north, Austin and his two young sons stumbled upon perhaps the most extensive prehistoric site ever unearthed in New York City. They dug up hundreds of arrowheads, stone tools, pottery shards, and animal bones later determined to date mostly from the late woodland period, a period that ended 1,000 years ago. But Austin excavated carelessly, failing to note relative depth or location of artifacts and thus scrambling forever the archaeological record. Still, if not for him, knowledge of Shanscomacoke might have been lost altogether. For in the 1930s, the entire site north of Avenue U was buried under many feet of sand and soil. What remains of this ancient place today lies beneath the ball fields and turf of Marine Park, especially its western half, south of Fillmore Avenue and Junior High School 278. Austin's hoard was scattered to the winds after he died. Fortunately, some of it passed to a prominent Long Island naturalist named Roy Latham, who later gifted the artifacts to the tiny Southold Indian Museum. They remain there today, across the road from an astronomical observatory named, oddly enough, for the grandniece of Indian fighter George Armstrong Custer. Austin was not the only one bewitched by this spectral corner of the city. So too was Frederick Van Wyck, a New Yorker of old Dutch stock whose cousin was the bumbling first mayor of Greater New York, Robert A. Van Wyck, whom we'll meet in Chapter 10. A broker by trade, Van Wyck had the time and money to indulge a lifelong passion for history and the arts. Several of his books were illustrated by his wife, Matilda Brown, a landscape painter who had studied with Thomas Moran. Like many men of his generation, Van Wyck was dismayed by the decline of Anglo-Dutch New York and the churning Babel that his city was becoming. Each wave of immigrants from Ellis Island seemed to send him on ever deeper recovery missions into the past. A man literally out of time, Van Wyck came to dwell, mentally and physically, in the New York of a bygone era, engrossed in the creation narrative of his city and social class, a real-life Diedrich Knickerbocker, narrator of Washington Irving's satirical History of New York. But obsessions of the creative sort often bear prized fruit. In 1924, Van Wyck published an extraordinary treatise on Brooklyn's earliest history entitled Keskechoke. Nearly 800 pages long, it is one of the most voluminous and assiduously researched works of local history ever published in the United States. In it, Van Wyck argued that the Stromkill and its uplands, a peninsula called Bay's Durian's Hook, heart of the Marine Park neighborhood today, might well have been Gotham's Plymouth Rock. First contact, in Van Wyck's view, may have taken place as early as 1609. On September 3 that year, Henry Hudson and the crew of the Half Moon swung up the coast around Sandy Hook and came to three great rivers. One of these was Raritan Bay, the other the Narrows, and the third Rockaway Inlet, then much farther east than it is today. A journal kept by Hudson's mate, Robert Jewett, indeed tells of an attempt to enter the northernmost of these rivers, but that shoals and sandbars and 10-foot water forced the ship back. As Van Wyck saw it, Hudson's first intention on the afternoon of September 3rd was to go into Jamaica Bay. This meant that, however briefly, the Half Moon probably came head-on in the direction of Flatlands, and that its crew could well have ended up making landfall at the mouth of the Stromkill. He imagined that every member of the tribe must have seen the strange object that loomed up on the horizon about 3 o'clock that afternoon, headed straight for the entrance to the bay. These Indians and their chiefs would have been more than mortal if they had not followed with the closest scrutiny every move the stranger made that afternoon until darkness came. Van Wyck also argued that crew members left behind by Dutch trading ships in 1614 and 1615 to dispose of goods might have wintered at Keskakeren under the protection of the great Chief Pennewits, thus making Flatlands possibly the oldest place of white abode in Greater New York. Van Wyck further conjectured that the Stromkill was the haven where Cornelius Hendrickson and the crew of the Unrust wintered in 1616. The Unrust, Restless, was the first ship built in the Americas, whose modest draft allowed it to navigate waters too shallow for the Half Moon. Hendrickson and Adrian Block, before him, used the craft to explore much of the Connecticut and Long Island coastlines, leading some to call it America's first research vessel. Even if Van Wyck was wrong about all this, about Hudson and wintering traders and the hunkered crew of the Unrust, Keskachogue was certainly settled by 1636, a full decade before the village of Broekelen on the waterfront at Fulton Street. It was thus among the first permanent settlements in New Netherland and the earliest place colonized by Europeans on Long Island. That summer, several major land conveyances were made to the Dutch by a delegation of Canarsie led by Chiefs Pennewits and Cacapateno, in exchange for certain merchandise and purportedly with the blessing and consent of the community. The first was made to Wolfert Gerritsen and Andreas Hude for the westernmost of the flats called Keskitu. The smaller, middle, and eastern prairies, known respectively as Kaskateu and Kaskateu, were conveyed to two Dutch West India Company agents still in their 20s, Jacobus van Corlier, first commissary of wares, and Wouter van Twiller, who had replaced Pieter Minuit as director general of New Netherland 3 years earlier. Hude was a surveyor from Amsterdam. Gerritsen had been a baker in the Utrecht town of Amersfoort before sailing to New Netherland in 1625. A forebear of the Roosevelt clan, he was recruited to run a farm in Lower Manhattan before striking out for Keskachogue. All told, some 3,600 acres were conveyed by Pennewits and Cacapateno, who almost certainly did not realize that the transactions would forever alienate their people from the land. For the eager and ambitious von Twiller, satirized as corpulent, bumbling Walter the Doubter by Washington Irving, who confused the youth with his father, the Kaskateu land grant was just another investment in an impressive portfolio that included most of Red Hook, a tobacco plantation in Greenwich Village and the islands known today as Wards, Randalls, Roosevelt, and Governors, the last a reference to Von Twiller himself. Though he had no interest in homesteading, he seems to have caused several structures to be erected on his land at Cascateo. One of these has miraculously survived to the present.
The Pieter Kleisen-Wyckoff House at Ralph Avenue and Clarendon Road.
With its medieval massing and steep sloped roof, the Wyckoff House is a true envoy from Gotham's deepest past, the oldest building in New York City. One of two or three oldest structures in all New York State, and the very first building designated by the Landmarks Preservation Commission when it was founded in 1965. Across the street from a car wash, a salvage yard, and a geriatric diaper supplier called Elderware, which Google Maps shows incorrectly but appropriately nonetheless as occupying the Wyckoff House itself. The building hovered on the edge of destruction for decades and was known locally in the 1980s as America's oldest crack house. It is today a lovingly managed house museum thronged by school children on field trips. Wolfert Gerritsen, the oldest and most experienced of the group, was the only one to take the whole settlement business seriously. He erected a house and barn at the northeast corner of Flatbush and King's Highway and called his spread the Bowery of Achterveldt, literally the farm beyond the plains. Hude, too, erected a number of buildings, including a tobacco barn and what may have been the old Sand Hole House raised in 1889 that stood on the north side of King's Highway at East 35th Street. Gerritsen's Achterveldt appears on the Manitous map, placed just north of an inlet, in all likelihood Gerritsen Creek, and keyed to an index by the number 36. Just below and to the left of this is a small building that is likely the Pieter Kleisen-Wyckoff House, which would have been about a year old by the time the map was drawn. Though Hude left for New Amsterdam in 1638 to become the colony's first surveyor general, he held on to his farm, leasing it in 1642 for an annual rent of 200 pounds of well-cured tobacco. Gerritsen remained at Achterveldt for the rest of his life. By the 1660s, it had become a vibrant rural village named New Amersfoort, after Gerritsen's old-world hometown. With the ascendance of English rule in 1664, New Amersfoort became the town of Flatlands. What made this place so vital to the Dutch was not good soil, but mollusk shells, or, more precisely, the tiny tubular beads drilled by the Indians from quahogs, whelks, and periwinkles known as wampum. Wampum had long been used for ceremonial purposes by the coastal Algonquians, but with the arrival of trade-obsessed Europeans, it gained a powerful new role as legal tender, and not only for trade with the Indians. Town records indicate that wampum was exchanged for a wide range of goods and services between 1647 and 1660, writes Lynn Chechi. And wages in wampum were paid to cowherders and carpenters and to a schoolteacher or laborer. As the species value soared, Canarsie Indian settlements at Narriok, Sheepshead Bay, Massabarkham, Gravesend, Mosquito Hole, Perdigot Basin, Equendito, Barren Island, Shanscomacoke, and especially Winnipeg, Bergen Beach, became the leading wampum production centers on Long Island. Located at the headwaters of the Stromkill and linked by trade routes to the East River and Long Island, Keskechogue became a busy entrepot, the Wall Street of the Indians, as Van Wyck called it, especially after the fur trade was thrown open by the Dutch in 1639. Wampum was the source and mother of the beaver trade, the precious lucre that both Dutch and English bartered a range of goods for: cloth, tools, guns, spirits, tobacco, and then carried north to exchange for beaver pelts from the Mahican and Mohawk peoples. The fur was ultimately shipped to Europe and sold at great profit, mostly to be pressed into felt for men's hats. Scholars have hypothesized that it was wampum, not agriculture or town founding, that led to the initial acquisition of coastal states like Keskachogue and the Stroomkil by the Dutch. These were, after all, the mints of the coin of the New World realm. This countered orders by the Dutch West India Company to find productive farm and pasture lands to sustain the colony, which was experiencing frequent food shortages and near starvation by 1633. Wolfert Gerritsen was involved in just such wampum speculating. He had been deputized in January 1630 to help an Amsterdam pearl and diamond merchant named Killian van Rensselaer build a New World empire trading wampum and pelts. Van Rensselaer was a founder of the West India Company, but it seems his real ambition was fattening his larder at company expense. He also happened to be Director General Wouter van Twiller's uncle. Several months after hiring Gerritsen, van Rensselaer secured a vast patroonship on the upper Hudson River, a 1,000-square-mile domain anchored by Fort Orange and the fur trade boomtown of Beaverwick, literally Beaver District, later named Albany. With the Stroomkil at one end and Beaverwick at the other, van Rensselaer had his hands in two of the three fur trade cookie jars. These machinations made him fabulously rich. They also got many of his cronies in trouble. In a March 1651 letter to Peter Stuyvesant, West India Company directors blasted van Rensselaer's minions and ordered the new director general to guard against unauthorized land grabs like those at Keskachogue, where very few improvements in regard to settling, cultivating, tilling, or planting have been made. They called out van Twiller for having greedily stretched out his hand for the two flats on Long Island, and castigated Gerritsen and Hudé for not settling the 50th part of their expansive tract. The following year, in July 1652, an ordinance was passed prohibiting men, covetous and greedy of land, from directly or indirectly buying or attempting to obtain any lands from the natives. Keeping such valuable land locked up prevented the planting of bowries and thus delayed and retarded the fruitful peopling of New Netherland. They also avoided all previous acquisitions of land, including both the small flats on Long Island claimed by the former director, Wouter van Twiller, and the great flat with the lands adjacent claimed by Wolfert Gerritsen and Andreas Hudé. This annulment would cast a 300-year cloud of doubt over the actual ownership of all this land. The Gerritsen-Hudé tract, especially, was the focus of a running legal battle that eventually pitted descendants of both families against Robert Moses and the City of New York. A latter-day Jarndyce versus Jarndyce that the Brooklyn Eagle described as the most intricate trial in the annals of the Brooklyn Supreme Court. Beaver pelts and wampum belts became lodestars of Indian life, too, but with far more malevolent effects. With their intimate knowledge of the coast and its shell fisheries, the Canarsie were well positioned to exploit the rising value of wampum. But it was a Faustian bargain. Prior to European contact, the Algonquian peoples led a peripatetic existence, living rudely and rovingly, as one observer put it, shifting from place to place. Even coastal tribes like the Canarsie stayed only part of the year at the shore, typically in summer. As fall approached, they moved inland, where there was plentiful wood for fires and game animals to provide meat, fat, and furs for warmth. With the new system of trade, life became more sedentary. Seasonal shore camps like Shanscomacoke became permanent or semi-permanent villages. A change revealed to archaeologists by dramatic increases in shell detritus and more extensive burial grounds. Ancient patterns of life were scuttled for wampum,
and a once proudly self-sufficient society gradually sank into a state of almost total dependence on Dutch and English trade. And then the whole rodent-based economy collapsed. Overhunting caused beaver populations throughout the Northeast to crash, bringing the entire trade triangle down with it. Wampum lingered. It was manufactured on Long Island into the 1870s to seal treaties with Indians on the western frontier. Twilight came fast for the Canarsie, their long day ending with dispossession and death from war and raging mortal disease. Keskachoga was deserted as early as 1640 at the outbreak of the bloody Governor Kieft War. These first people of the American land quietly vanished as noiselessly as the morning mists, wrote J. Thomas Scharf, disappearing before the advancing day. In 1670, Daniel Denton eulogized, "To say something of the Indians, there is now but few upon the island. How strangely they have decreased by the hand of God." The last Canarsie Indian was said to have died in 1832, buried in a shroud sewn by an old Dutch friend. Our earliest eyewitness account of the Stroomkill uplands was penned in 1679 by Dankerts and Sloiter, and describes a landscape strikingly similar to Holland. "There is toward the sea a large piece of low flat land," they wrote, "which is overflowed at every tide, miry and muddy at the bottom, and which produces a species of hard salt grass or reed grass. This was mown for hay," they noted, "which cattle would rather eat than fresh hay." The men were delighted to find the uplands around the Gerritsen estuary entirely covered with clover in blossom, which diffused a sweet odor in the air for a great distance. They described the region as low and level, without the least elevation, but indented with waterways, navigable and very serviceable for fisheries. On the Stroomkill itself, they came upon a grist mill driven by the water which they dam up in the creek. This structure, one of the earliest industrial buildings on the eastern seaboard, was erected by the Gerritsen clan between 1670 and 1686, when it appears in the Dongan patent. Rebuilt several times, it was the very essence of sustainability. Water, penned back at high tide behind a rock pile dam, was discharged as needed through a sluiceway, turning a drive wheel that powered the millstones via wooden gears and shafts and leather beltings. The plant produced flour for Washington's army and was pressed into similar service by Lord Cornwallis to feed his men before the Battle of Brooklyn, until Samuel Gerritsen, perhaps tired of being miller in the middle, disabled it by contriving to lose the millstones, at least according to local lore. Operating into the 1890s, the faded Red Mill was a local landmark, a picturesque ruin, its big wheel motionless yet still, giving forth a musical swish as the water boils below. Tragically, it burned to the ground on the night of September 4, 1935. A night watchman and police patrolman on site the night the mill burned claimed to have seen nothing. The mill was being restored by the Parks Department at the time, and plans for a total restoration as a working mill museum by architects Imar Embury II and H.B. Gwillin had just been completed. Though nothing remains of the mill except for a pair of stone posts that held the sluice gate, the tidal dam can still be seen at low tide just below Burnett Street at Avenue 5. Samuel Gerritsen's daughter, Elizabeth, married into the Lott family in 1799. That year, Hendrik I. Lott, Johannes's grandson and heir to the plantation, was busy erecting a substantial addition to the 1720 house. He had plenty of help. A 1792 inventory of the Lott farm lists no fewer than 12 enslaved African Americans, six men and six women, who undoubtedly helped construct the magnificent Dutch Federal House on what is today East 36th Street. Slavery was an essential element of New York life in the 17th and 18th centuries. As historian Shane White writes, New York was the center of the heaviest slaveholding region north of the Mason-Dixon line. Only Charleston, South Carolina, surpassed New York in the total number of enslaved residents. And no place in the state had more slaves per capita than Kings County, where one in three residents was in bonded servitude, a ratio that would not have been out of place in the South. This was especially the case in Dutch towns like New Utrecht, where 75% of white households owned slaves, or Midwout, Flatbush, where African Americans constituted 41% of the population in 1790. By this time, Kings County was supplying a lion's share of meat, vegetables, grains, fruits, and other farm products consumed by the surging city across the river. Proximity to urban markets made many Dutch families prosperous, fertilizing their fortunes as the manure they hauled from Gotham streets and stables fertilized their fields. Kings County became a land of lush and verdant bounty. "I remember no spot," recalled Timothy Dwight, "where the produce of so many kinds appeared so well. The wheat, winter barley, flax, and oats are remarkably fine. Indeed, wherever the country was cultivated," he observed, "its face resembled a rich garden." But Dwight ignored a vital aspect of the scene. However thorough a portrait his travels are of New York and Long Island 200 years ago, pages of meticulous observations on the manners and customs of Long Island folk and the geography, flora, and fauna of the region, he says nothing about the system of human bondage that created the pastoral scenes he so admired, about the forgotten souls who tilled the soil and helped feed the rising metropolis through its long childhood and adolescence. Dwight was not the only one to gloss over this aspect of Kings County life and labor. Most 19th century accounts of Brooklyn's past depict slavery in a warmly nostalgic light, pruning it carefully from uglier manifestations of slavery elsewhere in the world.
"This race for more than a century and a half," wrote Gertrude Lefferts Vanderbilt of African Americans in 1899,
"formed part of the family of every Dutch inhabitant of Kings County. Speaking the same language, brought up to the same habits and customs, with many cares and interests in common, there existed a sympathy with and an affection between them and the white members of the household such as could scarcely be felt toward the strangers who now performed the same labor under such different circumstances." To Vanderbilt and her circle, slavery in early New York was fundamentally different and better, writes Craig Stephen Wilder, than slavery in the southern colonies. So much so that they effectively recast the Knickerbocker Yankee enslavement of Africans as the single kindest act that one group of people ever visited upon another. Yet documentary evidence does suggest that the lot of slaves in New Netherland was not as cruel or repressive as in the West Indies or on the plantations of the South, that the position of free blacks was better there than perhaps anywhere else in the New World. As Edgar McManus has argued in A History of Negro Slavery in New York, the Dutch had little interest in creating a racialized caste system of the sort that would develop in the West Indies or the American South. "For neither the West India Company nor the settlers," he writes, "endorsed the specious theories of Negro inferiority used in other places to justify the system." The liberties enjoyed by free blacks in New Netherland bear this out. They could own property and serve in the militia. Jews could do neither. They could own white servants and intermarry with whites, and were accepted or rejected by the community on their own merits as individuals. Enslaved blacks had the same standing as whites in a court of law. and with a system of half-freedom that allowed conditional release. Bondage in the colony was often like a severe form of indentured servitude. There were indeed no slave uprisings in New Netherland, and the fact that the Dutch armed their bondsmen to fight enemies indicates a certain degree of trust. All told, McManus concludes, master-slave relations were good, and generally free of the corrosive hatred which in other colonies helped to create brutal systems of repression. It was only later, after the institution of harsher English controls over slaves, including a separate judicial system and legal code for bondspeople, that slavery in the city and its hinterlands began to take on its more egregious aspects. Kindly or not, Brooklyn's Dutch settlers practiced chattel slavery and prospered at the expense of men and women squeezed for their labor and deprived of freedom. They had the greatest need for labor in the pre-industrial city, and thus became New York's largest and most dedicated slave owners, more deeply engaged in extracting labor from bound Africans than any other ethnic group in the city's past. Even if later anti-Dutch sentiment greatly exaggerated their sins, so avaricious were the Knickerbockers, opined a visiting Frenchman in the 1790s, that they almost starve themselves and treat their slaves miserably, the truth remains that the pious Calvinists of Kings County not only owned Africans, writes Wilder, but advertised for runaways, auctioned human beings, and exhibited the violence, hypocrisy, and immorality that people who systematically exploit other people eventually must display. These little masters, as Wilder calls them, practiced an intimate form of slavery, but one no less morally repugnant than those of greater scale and brutality elsewhere. Many of these men would become vocal opponents of abolition and emancipation. They formed the Southern planter class in miniature, less systematically violent than their Virginia brethren, perhaps, but just as committed to a way of life premised upon the domination of other people. Those who excused slavery in Kings County vis-à-vis the industrial-scale enslavement of Africans in the plantation South failed to see that scattering the population of bondspeople so thinly impaired black family development, increased the possibility of sale of kinfolk, and exacerbated conditions for escape among isolated young men and women. And scores of men and women did indeed become blacks who stole themselves. One of these was a 16-year-old boy named Jack, who ran away in July 1783 from Jeremus Lott, who posted 5 guineas reward for his return. Johannes H. Lott's youngest son. He was not a kindly soul. A loyalist during the Revolution and notorious for his cruelty to our prisoners, Lott and 2 of his slaves were kidnapped by a band of New Jersey patriots in 1781, who hustled the trio to a whaleboat waiting in the Gerritsen marshes. The men were taken to New Brunswick, where Lott was compelled to ransom his Negroes. Jack escaped from Lott again in May 1784. That he bore an iron collar around his neck marked with the initials J.L. tells of a darker truth than what Gertrude Vanderbilt and her fellow gentry allowed to flow from their treacle-dipped pens. Kings County in the 18th century was among the least free places in New York State, its enslaved population quadrupling between 1703 and 1790. The heavily agricultural towns south of the Terminal Moraine, Flatbush, Flatlands, Gravesend, and New Utrecht, were akin to the coastal plain counties of Virginia and North Carolina, where most of the big slave-holding plantations of those states were located. While the Lotts owned a mere fraction of the slaves that worked a typical Virginia plantation at the time, they were nonetheless among the largest slaveholders in Kings County. As noted earlier, Hendrick Lott owned 12 bonded men and women in 1792. And then, Sometime before 1810, all of Lot's slaves were freed. As it is unlikely that so large a group of enslaved men and women would have been able to buy their freedom all at once, Lot almost certainly chose to emancipate his slaves. Federal census records indicate that he then hired most back as paid laborers. Some would remain in his employ into the 1840s. Only an elderly woman, for reasons unknown, was kept on in bondage. Why Lot would choose to suddenly free his bondspeople is a puzzle. He left no diary or letters to explain himself. Voluntary manumission was not unknown among slaveholders at this time. In fact, while the slave population of both New York and Kings County increased steadily all through the 18th century, census returns show a sudden drop in both places between 1800 and 1820. In Kings County, the number of enslaved residents fell by almost half, from 1,506 to 879. Manumissions were also up sharply. In New York City, there were a mere 36 recorded manumissions between 1791 and 1800, and 260 between 1801 and 1810. This was due not to a sudden outbreak of goodwill among slaveholders, but to a piece of legislation, the Gradual Manumission Act of 1799. It stipulated that all children of slave women born after July 4 that year were to be free, though they must remain indentured to their masters until the age of 25 for women and 28 for men. As Shane White writes, it was not until 1810 that the full impact of the act was felt in the city, with the number of New York slaveholders falling by more than 25% from 1800. The lowest number recorded in the city in any of the first three federal censuses. However extraordinary Lot's decision appears to us, it was fully in step with the evolving state of slavery at the time. The Gradual Manumission Act clearly signaled the coming of emancipation. While some slave owners would hold on to their chattel to the bitter end, others saw the writing on the wall and set their slaves free. Such decisions likely also involved agency and action on the part of the bondspeople themselves. As White has put it, once it was certain slavery would eventually end, slave owners became more susceptible to pressure from their slaves and often agreed to arrangements whereby slaves were liberated in consideration of a number of years of trouble-free service, or cash, or both. Indeed, Lot's manumitted slaves stayed and worked for the family long after being granted freedom, a fact typically attributed to loyalty and affection, but that was more likely simply part of the deal. And yet manumission literally involved letting go of an investment. Such an action, the willful reduction of one's own capital, begs an explanation. Lot no doubt surmised that full emancipation was on the horizon, but he could not have known it would happen in 1827, the year slavery was abolished in New York State. In other words, freeing his slaves circa 1810 deprived his three children of a substantial inheritance. So it is possible, at least, that other factors account for Lot's action. That perhaps he manumitted his slaves because he believed it was the right thing to do. Indeed, Lot family lore suggests that Hendrick might have been an early abolitionist. The evidence is thin. We know that he was a member of the Flatlands Dutch Reformed Church, buried in its churchyard at East 40th Street and over Baugh Place, and that manumission was considered a meritorious act in the eyes of God, but it is unclear whether Lot was pious enough to let faith overrule financial interest. Moreover, faith of the Dutch Reformed sort did not imply charity on the racial front. The Dutch Reformed Church was perhaps the least progressive of the Protestant sects in New York, and long vacillated on whether to allow Africans into its fold. The learned and popular minister, Henricus Selwyns, who served congregations in New Amsterdam and Long Island, instructed enslaved Africans in the faith, but would not baptize a baby if he suspected its parents wanted nothing else than to deliver their children from bodily slavery without striving for piety and Christian virtues. Indeed, baptism of the bonded became a matter of great controversy. Some ministers came down forcefully on the side of the angels. Godefriedus Udemans, writing in 1638, argued that a Christian was faith-bound to free any slaves who converted to his faith. For if they were willing to submit themselves to the lovely yoke of our Lord Jesus Christ, Christian love requires that they be discharged from the yoke of human slavery. But colonial empires are built on greed and grim expedience, not Christian kindness. Slave owners in 17th century New Netherland, fearful of the losses conversion might entail, not to mention that it might give the Negroes ideas about liberty and freedom, discouraged missionary work among their slaves. The matter was eventually settled in 1706, out of church and not by the Dutch, but by the English colonial legislature of New York, which made it completely legal, if not moral, for a Christian to be enslaved. All told, there was little to admire, writes church historian Gerald de Jong, regarding the attitude of the Dutch Reformed Church towards slavery in colonial America. Manumission of the lot slaves has seeded stories that Hendrick's house provided refuge for runaway slaves, that it was, in other words, a way station or depot on the Underground Railroad. Lot descendants alive today recall hearing stories as children that fugitives were given sanctuary on the farm, that ships came quietly in the night to shore, recalls one family member, and the people who were part of the Underground Railroad would shepherd the slaves into the house. Of course, tales like this envelop nearly every antebellum house, church, and tavern this side of the Mason-Dixon line. Were a nickel set aside for each property rumored to be part of the Underground Railroad, the federal debt could be paid off in a day. It is not surprising that many would claim connection to this heroic chapter in American history for reasons of collective sin cleansing, if nothing else. The Underground Railroad is an epic part of our national mythology, as hopeful as it is hopelessly misunderstood. Only in recent years has the traditional narrative of the railroad as the infrastructure of white magnanimity given way to a more nuanced view of its fractal-like complexity, and greater agency accorded freedom seekers themselves in its actual operation. The very nature of the Underground Railroad, secretive, spontaneous, always in the shadows, makes it a notoriously difficult subject to research. It is virtually impossible to test the veracity of claims like those of the Lot family. The best we can do is expose them to the light of analysis, marshaling evidence from geography, historical context, and archaeology. Is it possible that the Lots helped spirit enslaved African Americans to freedom? In a word, yes. To start, there is no question that Kings County played a central role in helping move escaped slaves north in the 19th century, especially after the draconian Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. Henry Ward Beecher's Plymouth Church in Brooklyn Heights, a topic of Chapter 10, was widely hailed as the Grand Central Depot of the Underground Railroad. Though he was hardly blameless himself, Beecher's thunderous oratory did as much for American abolitionism as did his sister Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Kings County was also home to Willis Augustus Hodges, a free black Virginian who ran an anti-slavery newspaper in Williamsburg, and abolitionist orator James W.C. Pennington sought refuge in Brooklyn after escaping bondage in Maryland. The latter went on to become the first African American to study at Yale, and later helped integrate streetcar lines in both Brooklyn and New York City. The rural southern half of Kings County was a far less tolerant place, and yet there were exceptions. During the draft riots of 1863, blacks fleeing mob violence in Brooklyn and across the East River were hidden in an ancient windmill on the John C. Vanderveer farm between Canarsie Lane and the long-vanished Perdiget Pond. It was a good place to take refuge. Built in 1804, the mill was a fortress of strength, with a stone foundation and oak timbers 28 feet high and nearly 3 feet thick. It was being used as a barn at the time, the great sails having been wrecked in a storm decades earlier. Like the Gerritsen Tide Mill, the Vanderveer plant was also lost to fire, burning on the night of March 4, 1879, in a spectacle of destruction that sent up showers of sparks, like gold dust sprinkled on a cloth of blue. The geography of the outwash plain may itself have aided bids for freedom. The marshy shore of Jamaica Bay, with its reed-choked serpentine estuaries, would have offered a hidden backdoor entry into Brooklyn and New York City for fugitives coming by boat from New Jersey and points south. The Lot Farm included most of the secluded north bank of Gerritsen Creek, the largest tidal estuary on the bay and navigable by ships as far as the mill dam. Van Wyck recalled, "Sloops of 24 tons burden, and in one case 30 tons, making trips in the 1870s between the Gerritsen Mill and New York City, before either Mill Creek or the Stromkill had been dredged." At the east end of the dam was Kimball Landing, from which an old Indian path, known as Lot's Lane or the Stromkill Trail, led to Flatlands Village, literally passing between the Lot House and its stone kitchen building. In other words, freedom seekers could have been ushered to the house in swift and total secrecy. We know that tidal estuaries similar to Gerritsen Creek were used for just such purposes farther out on Long Island, where a network of sympathetic Quaker meetings offered sanctuary to runaways. One was the Jerusalem River, known today as Belmore Creek, which led to a settlement of free blacks near present-day Wantagh, known as the Brush. This place, nestled amidst the large Quaker community of Jerusalem, was also a waypoint and destination for freedom seekers coming out of New York and Brooklyn. By the 1830s, there was an African free school there, and later an African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. In its burial ground nearby, itself now buried in a Levitt subdivision at about 1460 Oakfield Avenue, were interred the remains of several men who fought in the Civil War with the 20th and 26th Regiments of the United States Colored Troops. But Gerritsen Creek and the Lot House led to an even greater prize. Weeksville, one of the largest free black communities in the United States. Just 4 miles to the north, Weeksville developed in the 1830s on the northernmost lands of the old Gerritsen land grab and soon became a major destination for those escaping bondage from the south. Nearly 45% of Weeksville adult residents in 1850 were born below the Mason-Dixon line, many of whom, perhaps most, were former slaves. Weeksville's proportion of Southern-born African Americans, writes Judith Wellman in Brooklyn's Promised Land, was one of the highest of any city in the United States. Only Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Buffalo, and Cincinnati, all major gateways to freedom, had higher proportions of African Americans born in the South. While many of these people came to Weeksville via New York and Brooklyn, it is very likely that others came up from flatlands just to the south. Weeksville would have been about an hour's walk or a 20-minute wagon ride from the Lot House via Flatlands Neck Road and Hunterfly Road, from the Dutch Anderfly, or over to the marshes. One of Weeksville's earliest residents was himself a former Lot slave, Samuel Anderson, born into bondage in 1810. Anderson's master was Jeremiah Lot, who clearly did not agree that those baptized into the Christian flock deserved emancipation. A devout man, and later a preacher himself, Anderson was baptized as a youth and attended services at the Flatbush Dutch Reformed Church, where blacks were required to sit apart from whites in an upstairs gallery. The men on one side, he recalled, the women on the other. The most telling bit of evidence that the lots may well have offered sanctuary to fugitive slaves is in the building itself. As a child in the 1960s, Catherine Lott Divis, a direct descendant of Hendrik Lott, whose father grew up in the East 36th Street house, was told in hushed tones by her elderly aunts about a secret hiding place on the second floor. They took me upstairs with great fanfare and solemn tones and showed me the room, she told the New York Times in 2002. At the back of a large closet, behind hat boxes and a rack of clothes, was a small, low door papered over with newsprint from 1862. Behind it was a tiny, hidden room. There, Divis was told, fugitive slaves smuggled in by boat would be hidden before continuing on to freedom. I was not to breathe a word of it, she said. For, by her family's unspoken code, if something was a secret in the 1800s, it was always a secret. The house had other tales to tell, coaxed into the light by a team of Brooklyn College archaeologists who began studying the house in 1998. Led by Christopher Ricciardi and Alyssa Luria, the students dug more than 70 trenches on the site, patiently sifting through several tons of excavate. They uncovered the foundations of the old plastered brick kitchen house, raised around 1927 to make way for East 36th Street, and over the four-year project period unearthed thousands of pottery shards, glass and ceramic fragments, pipe stems, toys, including several haunting doll heads, clam and oyster shells, and other faunal remains. The detritus of long and prosperous habitation by scores of women, men, and children. Yet the most extraordinary discovery at the Lott House was not underground, but overhead. One afternoon, a project assistant bumped her head on the ceiling in the 18th century lean-to addition close to East 36th Street. The ceiling appeared to give way. Luria and Ricciardi grabbed a ladder and flashlights. In the ceiling, they found a covered hatch, behind which were the truncated remains of a staircase. The stairs apparently once continued to the ground and led to the second floor of the 1720 house, where a door had long ago been sealed off. Climbing up, the pair discovered twin garret rooms in the attic space on either side of the stairs. The rooms were low and small, about 10 feet square and at most 4 feet high. The doors to the garret rooms had been removed, but lay close by. Centuries-old candle wax was splattered all about. When Luria and Ricciardi took up some floorboards, they discovered something truly astonishing. An assortment of objects that had been placed carefully beneath each entrance before the floorboards were nailed down. On the north side was a pelvis bone from a sheep or goat, an oyster shell, a small pouch tied with hemp, and an 18th-century child's shoe. On the south side were several corn cobs, one whole, the other snapped in half and set at right angles above and below the first in the form of a cross. What Luria and Ricciardi had come upon were arrays of religious talismans, clearly African in origin. They had discovered the living quarters of at least some of the Lott family slaves. Caches of objects like these were previously known only in the South. Never before had anything like this been seen in New York. As Luria explains, the objects were meant as defensive talismans against certain malevolent spirits, to create a kind of protective spell for the occupants, and were usually placed near doors and fireplaces where spirits were thought to come and go. The crossed corn cobs were themselves likely a microcosm of the universe itself, a Bakongo cosmogram in which the horizontal plane, the unbroken cob, was meant to symbolize separation, says Luria, of the world of the living from the realm of the dead. Through the dark of 2 centuries, visited only by spiders and mice, the crossed cobs consecrate still a small, fraught corner of the world, a simple act of faith by a people far from home. Chapter 2. Lady Deborah's City by the Sea. For we are as a young tree or little sprout, for the first time shooting forth to the world. George Baxter et al., 1651. 2 miles east of Garrison Creek is an urban fossil, the remains of one of the oldest planned towns in North America, the first founded by a woman and the first to mandate religious freedom by formal charter. Unlike the Lot House, the sublime order of Gravesend is not evident to an explorer on foot. The streets here appear jumbled and chaotic, some inexplicably short, others set at crazy angles. This is not a particularly charming part of town, not a place where one expects to find a palimpsest from Gotham's deepest past. The F train lumbers noisily over McDonald Avenue, above the body shops and roofing suppliers. A furniture outlet sits on one corner, near a Chinese steel fabricator, a Korean Bible church, and a sketchy-looking nightclub. But rise above the ground plane chaos here, and something extraordinary pulls into focus. A tiny four-square grid, cocked at an odd angle from the city grid. A Cartesian insect trapped in urban amber. It is a monument to a mysterious soul, an enigmatic Englishwoman named Deborah Moody, whose life and ultimate fate have perplexed antiquarians for generations. She was a child of the nobility, born around 1585 to the Dunch family of Priory Manor, Little Wittenham, in the county of Berkshire. Her mother was Deborah Pilkington, daughter of the Bishop of Durham. Her father, Walter Dunch, had been a member of Parliament during the reign of Elizabeth I. Oliver Cromwell may have been a relative by marriage on her father's side. In 1606, Dunch married a nobleman named Henry Moody, later granted peerage as a baronet by King James I. The couple made their home at Moody's estate, Guardston Manor in Wiltshire, a short walk from the ancient Avebury stone circle, less famous but arguably more significant than its sister UNESCO World Heritage Site at Stonehenge. By 1608, the couple had 2 children, Henry and Catherine. Sir Henry died in 1629, leaving a large fortune. After being widowed, Deborah Moody moved several times and eventually took up residence in London. This transience ran her afoul of a statute limiting the length of time a person could remain away from his hereditary home. It was no trifling matter, for in April 1635, Moody was summoned by the Court of the Star Chamber, which met in secret and was known for harsh and draconian rulings. The court found Dame Deborah Moody guilty and gave her 40 days to get back home to Wiltshire, in the good example necessary to the poorer classes. It has long been assumed that around this time Moody also began espousing dangerously radical ideas about religion, becoming a convert to Anabaptism, a heretical creed in England. As Austin P. Stockwell put it in 1884, Moody evidently chafed under the unlawful restraints of such a civil and ecclesiastical despotism, and in 1639 left England for the presumed freedom and tolerance of America. If this was indeed her motivation for taking leave of Albion, recent scholarship suggests otherwise, she was soon to be disappointed. Some 20,000 Puritans emigrated to the Massachusetts Bay Colony between 1629 and 1640, many of whom settled in a chain of coastal towns north of Boston. Deborah Moody was among them. Exactly when she set foot in the New World is unclear, but by early 1640 she had made her way to Saugus, and on May 13 gained approval from the Massachusetts General Court to purchase a spread of several hundred acres known as the Swampscott Farm. The transaction left her nearly bankrupt. She was almost undone, wrote Thomas Letchford in 1641, by buying Master Humphrey's farm. Moody joined the Puritan congregation in nearby Salem, a place whose own date with history was fast approaching. It was there that Moody became imbued with the erroneous idea, as chronicler Alonzo Lewis put it in 1844, that the baptism of infants was a sinful ordinance. The whole issue of the validity of infant baptism may strike us as ecclesiastical hair-splitting. Anabaptists argued that nowhere in Scripture was such a practice sanctioned, and that for baptism to have any meaning, the individual undergoing the rite must possess some minimal understanding of its implications. In their view, to offer a whimpering infant, wholly ignorant of right and wrong, admission to the kingdom of heaven was blasphemous. Why not also baptize the barnyard cat? Most Protestants opposed the Anabaptist position, as did the Roman Catholic Church, hardly surprising given the high rate of infant mortality at the time. Moreover, Anabaptists had a bad reputation. In 1534, a group of them in Munster had attempted to establish a theocracy, advocating the use of force to bring about the new Jerusalem predicted in Scripture. Fear that all Anabaptists were hot-headed radicals led to severe persecution of the sect in Europe. Tens of thousands were martyred, often by drowning. To Winthrop and the Massachusetts Puritans, Anabaptism was right alongside Quakerism as one of the damnable heresies threatening their New World project. Moody, who was said to have imbibed her Anabaptism from Roger Williams, founder of the Rhode Island colony, soon learned just how deep this antipathy ran. The Puritan clerisy was in no mood for theological magnanimity in 1640, especially involving a woman. Only several years earlier, Anne Hutchinson had stirred up a hornet's nest for mocking the pious learned scholars and professing antinomianism, a belief that faith alone determined one's salvation, not obedience to some compulsory code of moral law. To Winthrop, Hutchinson posed a grave threat to his model of Christian charity. She was arrested in 1637, convicted of heresy, and banished from the Massachusetts Bay Colony. Hutchinson, an inspiration for Hester Prynne and Nathaniel Hawthorne's Scarlet Letter, made her way to Rhode Island and then New Netherland, where she settled at Pelham Bay in the Bronx. Hutchinson's life among the Dutch was brief. She was murdered, along with several of her children, by a band of Sewanoy Algonquins in August 1643. Now Winthrop had another Jezebel on his hands. On December 14, 1642, after several reprimands, Moody was arrested and arraigned with two other women at the quarterly court in Salem for holding that the baptizing of infants is no ordinance of God. Winthrop then enacted a decree calling for the immediate expulsion of Anabaptists, accusing them of subverting Puritan rule and even questioning the lawfulness of making war. They were, he wrote, incendiaries of the commonwealth and the infectors of persons in matters of religion, troublers of churches in all places where they have been. Now, anyone who condemned or opposed baptizing infants risked being banished to the wilderness like the scapegoat of the Israelites. And speaking out on the matter was hardly necessary. Winthrop's ordinance made clear that even persons who purposely depart the congregation during a baptism would be arrested for sedition. Thus facing expulsion from Massachusetts Bay, Moody took off on her own, striking west for New Netherland in early 1643. My Lady Moody, mourned the Reverend Thomas Cobbett of Saugus, is to sit down on Long Island from under civil and church watch. Nor would she go alone. A large group of fellow worshippers from Salem and neighboring congregations joined her, all of whom, Winthrop railed, Moody had infected with Anabaptism. And yet Winthrop admitted a begrudging admiration for this thorn among his New World roses. My Lady Moody, he called her, a wise and anciently religious woman. New Netherland, booming, profane, and lusty, was a world away from the black-frocked severity of Puritan Massachusetts. Effectively a free trade zone established by the Dutch West India Company, its first order of business was business. The burgeoning provincial capital of New Amsterdam, at the southern tip of Manhattan, was a medley of ethnicity, race, and creed. A polyglot community, a confusion of tongues and people drawn from all over the world. It was as tolerant of difference and dissent, within reason, as the Puritan theocrats were not. An eclectic array of free men, slaves, and indentured servants, merchants, seamen, and traders gathered on the cobbled streets of embryonic Gotham, mixed with an even more motley assemblage of losers and scallywags, as Russell Shorto has put it, waiting around for the winds of fate to blow them off the map. It was here that Deborah Moody and her Anabaptist band came to build a new life. They were not only tolerated, but warmly welcomed, for very practical reasons. The director of New Netherland, Willem Kift, couldn't care less when a baby was baptized. What he needed were permanent settlers, pious or not, who would make the desert bloom, feeding New Netherland and turning it into a lasting colony. Traders and merchants made for a thriving entrepot, but without a stable base of agrarians, New Netherland would never sustain itself or grow. And here was a whole band of farmers and artisans, a little village in the making. All they needed was some land, which Kift had more than he knew what to do with. In June 1643, Moody was issued a patent for a large tract of land near Coney Island, a place far removed from New Amsterdam, just in case the English newcomers caused trouble. Kift named the place Gravesend, not for the English port city, but Gravenzande, his birthplace on the Maas River Delta in Holland. The newcomers threw themselves into the long work of settlement, but there was trouble in the land. Willem Kift was possibly the worst chief executive ever to rule the future New York City, an impulsive tyrant whom Washington Irving satirized as William the Testy, a waspish tinhorn prone to valorous broils, altercations, and misadventures. Only months before Moody's arrival, Kift touched off a bloody conflict with local Indians after they resisted his attempts to squeeze them for tribute. When his council of 12 men, the first representative democratic body in the Dutch colonies, balked at endorsing a plan of war, he simply dissolved it and forbade the men to meet. In February 1643, Kift sent troops to attack a refugee encampment of Wekwezik and Tappan Indians near today's Jersey City, killing 80 people. Young children, some of them snatched from their mothers, were cut to pieces before the eyes of their parents, wrote David DeVries, Kift's former council chief. Other babes were bound on planks and then cut through, stabbed, and miserably massacred so that it would break a heart of stone. DeVries was sickened by the slaughter, which he described as a disgrace to our nation. Kift, on the other hand, thanked the men for this deed of Roman valor. In retaliation, Algonquin warriors carried out a series of equally brutal raids throughout the region in subsequent months, including the one that killed Anne Hutchinson at Pelham Bay. By the time Kift's war was over in the fall of 1645, hundreds of colonists and some 1,600 Indians had been killed. Trade was at a standstill, and farms lay idle. Immigration had all but ceased, and many settlers left the colony altogether. Those remaining were on the verge of mutiny. All told, it was a very bad time to be coming on board. Indeed, Moody's fragile encampment was attacked repeatedly in its first year at Gravesend, forcing her band to seek refuge at nearby New Amersfort. Eventually, the settlers erected stout enough dwellings and a defensive stockade that enabled them to repel marauders. Yet survival seemed precarious, so much so that Moody contemplated returning to Massachusetts. In the aftermath of Hutchinson's murder in the fall of 1643, she wrote John Winthrop to ask his advice. It is not known whether he responded, but upon learning of her query, John Endicott, deputy governor of the Massachusetts Bay Colony, penned a missive to Winthrop himself, in which he advised against allowing Moody back, unless she signal repentance and leave her opinions behind her. "For she is a dangerous woman," he warned, "and it is very doubtful whether she will be reclaimed." Endicott then added, one imagines with a sudden shudder of dread, "The Lord rebuke Satan, the adversary of our souls." Hostilities between the Dutch and the Indians eventually cooled, and on December 19, 1645, Governor Kieft issued the Gravesender a new and more robust patent to the land that had been their tenuous home for more than 2 years now. In it, Kieft granted, "Ye honored Lady Deborah Moody and her associates a certain quantity or parcel of land, together with all ye havens, harbors, rivers, creeks, woodland, marshes, upon and about ye westernmost part of Long Island." The settlers were to enjoy and possess this land with full authority to build a town or towns with such necessary fortifications as to them seem expedient. But the most remarkable passage came next, for in it Kieft stipulated that the Gravesenders were to both govern themselves, to erect a body politic, and make such civil ordinances as the mayor part of ye inhabitants shall think ye fit for their quiet and peaceable subsisting, and enjoy free liberty of conscience, without molestation or disturbance from any magistrate or magistrates or any other ecclesiastical minister that may pretend jurisdiction over them." Deborah Moody's Gravesend settlement thus became only the second in America founded on principles of religious freedom, established 9 years after Roger Williams founded Providence Plantation as a haven from religious persecution. But Gravesend was the very first to legislate religious freedom in its founding charter. In this, Moody's town was 5 years ahead of the Toleration Act that mandated religious tolerance in Lord Baltimore's Maryland colony, and 12 years ahead of the Seminole Flushing Remonstrance. What kind of place was Gravesend, circa 1645? It was wild, to be sure, much of it heavily wooded and home to wolves, bear, and possibly the long-extinct eastern elk. It was flushed by seaborne winds, scored with tidal creeks, on the edge of a bay teeming with fish and crabs. But it was not a howling wilderness. In a letter to John Winthrop's son, George Baxter described the land Kieft allotted his group as "a place not yet settled on Long Island, and so commodious that I have not seen or known a better." In fact, it had long been inhabited by Native Americans. And though the exact spot chosen for the new town had never been settled, it was a junction of two old Indian paths. One, today's McDonald Avenue, ran south to the sea from the Mekawaniink Trail, King's Highway. The other, Gravesend Neck Road, led east to the Stromkill and Shanscomacook. There were also at least two other Europeans in the immediate area. For Kieft had granted, in 1639, a 200-acre plantation in the vicinity to a Moor named Anthony Jansen Van Sale. Vanselli, known as the Turk, was a character every bit as memorable as Deborah Moody, whom he came to know well. His father had been a notorious privateer on the Barbary coast, a convert to Islam, and ruler of a short-lived city-state called Saleh in what is now Morocco. Vanselli was born in Cartagena, Spain, in 1607, and spent time in North Africa and Amsterdam before coming to New Netherland around 1630. He and his salty German-born wife, Gretje Reyniers, were renegades of a different sort, and exiles, too. The pair was ordered to leave New Amsterdam after repeated legal disputes, financial trouble, and quarrels with clergy over their libertine ways. The original litigious New Yorker, Vanselli was in court more than he was home, hauled in for, among other things, aiming a loaded pistol at slave overseers of the Dutch West India Company and passing off a dead goat as payment for a debt. The angry Moor was derided as a drunk and denounced as a rogue and horned beast. At Gravesend, the unrepentant couple evidently got along well enough with Deborah Moody, though the boorish Vanselli fought constantly with her Oxford-educated poet son. In the first of several legal actions, Henry Moody dragged Vanselli into court after the latter stormed his house, calling him names and abusing his servant with evil language. Aside from their shared traits of grit and gumption, it's unlikely that the pious Lady Moody and Gretje Reyniers would have had much to bond over. Reyniers had been an Amsterdam barmaid before turning to prostitution, a line of work she evidently kept up after marrying Vanselli. She regularly provoked moral outrage in New Amsterdam with her licentious behavior, no easy thing in the raffish colony. When some sailors called her a 2 pounds butter whore, she hiked up her skirt, slapped her rump, and shouted, "Blaze, my dear Ackerton, kiss my ass," roughly translated. Deborah Moody was America's first woman town planner. For in this primeval place, she etched an exquisite diagram for spatial order. 4 squares of 4 acres each, aligned to the cardinal points of the compass and scored by streets running north-south and east-west. The ancient Roman Cardo and Decumanus on New World soil. It was only the second town in Anglo-Dutch America planned as a precisely surveyed grid, laid out, as 19th-century chronicler Nathaniel S. Prime opined, with a great deal of taste. From its center, an array of lot lines were plotted, like spokes of a wheel, to create triangled home lots for each of the settler families. Communal pasture land and woodlots lay beyond. As a diagram, the Gravesend plan is one of the most striking in American history, an essential mark of human will on the land, reaching outward across space as if to tap the very life force itself. But this was no dreamy utopia. Given the political situation of New Netherland at the time, the first order of business here was sanctuary and safety. The tight 4-square layout made Gravesend easy to defend, aided by a stockade of sharpened timber stakes, a fence of palisados of 6 foot. Close scrutiny the plan reveals at each of the 4 corners, guard posts in the form of tiny vestigial bastions. The radial bloom of planting fields, too, so evocative of a flower in the sun, was itself the result of expedience and pragmatism. Not only could such an array be quickly surveyed from a single station point, but the triangular fields enabled settlers to work their own holdings as close in or as far from the secure town center as the threat of attack necessitated. In time of conflict, huddling close to the nest. In time of peace, moving outward into a progressively expanding realm. Gravesend may have been founded by a devout noblewoman seeking religious freedom, but it began in a time of war, even surveyed by a military officer, James Hubbard, one of Moody's original patentees and the town's first constable, or schout. Like most English surveyors at the time, Hubbard was trained in the martial arts. And rectilinear town plans, easy to lay out and easy to defend, had been a mainstay of military science since the gridded castra of ancient Rome. But the Gravesend plan may have drawn upon a yet more lofty source of inspiration. Deciphering its hidden code requires tracing Moody's journey from Massachusetts to New Netherland. We do not know her exact itinerary, but can be fairly certain the voyage was made by ship and took the group around Cape Cod, past Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard, into the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.